Good morning, children of God. Welcome to worship today. Everybody there? I haven't heard any good mornings back. I'm sorry. Thank you. We are so glad to have Deb back. Yay! But I'm so grateful that Jim could play for us last week. There's a couple of announcements I want to point out. The Lenten worship schedule is on the back. And rather than doing services back and forth this year, I'm going to do at 4:30 each week, the service will be here. And at 6:30 each week, the service will be at Christ's. So if the early service doesn't work, you can go to Christ's. And if the late service doesn't work for them, they can come here. It'll be the same service. So I'm going to try that this year and see if that works. And the same times for Ash Wednesday services. Blue Valley Lutheran Homes is now accepting volunteers again. If you were one of the people that like to play cards and do things with the residents, or if you like to do that, they encourage people to contact them. Inside the back cover is information about what the Lutheran World Relief is doing for the earthquake victims. And I noticed that it says earthquake in Turkey. And so I asked them, I said, what about Syria? And unfortunately, Syria right now, because of their politics, is not allowing people to come in and do rescue efforts. I imagine they will, but there's a lot of things involved in it that Lutheran World Relief said it's actually kind of dangerous for them to go in there right now. So they're going to start with Turkey. They're going to expand into Syria as best as they can. But and they do get quilts in occasionally, but it's difficult. It's hard to picture, you know. We're so protected, and we have programs and things in our country, and you know, all kinds of organizations and things. It's hard to understand what they go through. But anyway, it explains, if you would like to give a donation, how to do it. You write "quake." I got a better term where I can read it in the memo line of a check, so that they can make sure it gets put towards earthquake relief. So. Wanted to present that. This week, on Friday, at 10:30 in the morning, there will be a funeral here, and it is for Dale Ahrens, who lives in Davenport, and worked for Steve for 30 years, or worked with Steve for Steve for 30 years, and Steve and Lyle. So you may or may not know him. He was 59 and died quite suddenly. So anyway, we're honored to be considered to help his family at this time. And Bible study Monday, like usual, the men's Bible study will meet at 6 p.m. this time only. It's a change of time due to the Milo Days meeting. That's at 7 here in town. So the Carlton Fire Department is having their bingo on February 19th. What time was that? Is that 7 to 9?
3 to 5.
Oh, 3 to 5. Boy, was I off on that. Yeah, boy, no kidding. So 3 to 5 for that. It helps the fire department. Any other announcements we need to make? Refreshments after church, of course, and fellowship time. Any announcements? Looking good. Okay, let's begin our worship then. Our worship begins on page 3 with our confession and forgiveness. Please stand as you're able. We invite the Holy Spirit to be present as we begin our worship. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who makes all things new, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. Trusting in God's mercy, let us confess our sin. Holy One, source of our renewal, we confess that we are wrapped up in sin and cannot free ourselves. We have not practiced your righteousness. Our hearts have turned away from you. For your name's sake and the sake of the world you so love, forgive us, that we may be reconciled to one another. For the glory of your holy name, amen. Thus says our God, The former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare. God's mercy makes us new. We are forgiven in the name of Christ our Savior. Amen. Our gathering hymn is 582. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Pray the prayer of the day together. It's found on the front of the insert. O God, the strength of all who hope in you, because we are weak mortals, we accomplish nothing good without you. Help us to see and understand the things we ought to do, and give us grace and power to do them. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
The first reading is from the 30th chapter of Deuteronomy, beginning with the 15th verse. Moses said to the people, "See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I am commanding you today, by loving the Lord your God, walking in his ways, and observing his commandments, decrees, and ordinances. Then you shall live and become numerous, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering and to possess. But if your heart turns away and you do not hear, but are led astray to bow down to other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, observing him, and holding fast to him. For that means life to you and length of days, so that you may live in the land that the Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. The word of the Lord. The second reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 1 through 9. Brothers and sisters, I could not speak to you as spiritual people, but rather as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ. I fed you with milk, no solid food, for you were not ready for solid food. Even now you are still not ready, for you are still of the flesh. For as long as there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not of the flesh and behaving according to human inclinations? For when one says, I belong to Paul, and another says, I belong to Apollos, are you not merely human? What then is Apollo? What is Paul? Servants through whom you came to believe as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollo watered, but God gave the growth. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. The one who plants and the one who waters have a common purpose, and each will receive wages according to the labor of each. For we are God's servants, working together. You are God's field, God's building. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand as you're able for the reading of the gospel. We begin with the gospel acclamation on page 5 of the bulletin. Alleluia! You are the light of the world. A city set upon a hill cannot be hid. Alleluia. The Gospel according to Matthew, the 5th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to the disciples, "You have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, 'You shall not murder, and whoever murders shall be liable to judgment.' But I say to you that if you are angry with a brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment. And if you insult a brother or sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say, 'You fool,' you will be liable to the hell of fire. So when you are offering your gift at the altar, if you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother or sister, and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you're on the way to court with him, or your accuser may hand you over to the judge, and the judge to the guard, and you will be thrown into prison. Truly I tell you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. You have heard that it was said, 'You shall not commit adultery.' But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to go into hell. It was also said, 'Whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce.' But I say to you that anyone who divorces his wife, except on the grounds of unchastity, causes her to commit adultery, and whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, you shall not swear falsely, but carry out the vows that you have made to the Lord. But I say to you, do not swear at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by the earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not swear by your head, for you cannot make one hair white or black. Let your word be yes, yes, or no, no. Anything more than this comes from the evil one. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Would the kiddos like to come forward? No? That works. Because that means I'm going to put you all to work. We have a room full of children of God. Now, in our worship service, we come to a part, and it's usually right before the offering or before communion starts, where the pastor says, the peace of Christ be with you always. And everybody responds, and also with you. And then we invite you to turn to your neighbor and to share God's peace. Now, I've seen it in churches where they start talking about the weather and, you know, that's a really nice dress you have and what are you having for dinner and whatever. And while that kind of conversation is wonderful, the peace is actually meant as a way to say to each other, I forgive you, God's peace be with you. It's kind of based on the idea that's found in our gospel lesson. I don't have it in my hand. In our gospel lesson where it talks about leaving your sacrifice before the altar, you know, before you make that sacrifice, you leave it and you go and reconcile yourself to your brother. And it's placed in our worship service generally before we start the communion, because that way you've had a chance to turn to your neighbor and say, God's peace be with you, before you approach the altar. So that's kind of the history on that. I will say that I knew of one church that decided to try it at the first part of the service because people tended to really get carried away, and it took the pastor about 15 minutes to get church started, so they changed that. So. But that has nothing to do with the fact that it's actually a part of our worship. God's peace be with you. So let's pray. Dear Lord, I thank you so much for this congregation, for the children of God that are gathered here. Lord, I thank you also that you give us the opportunity to share peace with each other, to forgive each other, and to share your love with each other. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Have you ever played a game where you don't remember the rules? Oh, perhaps it was something you played a long time ago and you kind of remember. Or maybe it was just a really complicated game and you never quite understood all the rules anyway. Maybe you were a child or you're playing games with your grandchild or with a child and they couldn't understand the rules, so you just, you know, moved your piece and spun the dial or drew your cards and you just enjoyed the game, whatever it was. My niece and I tried playing shuffleboard once, but since we had no clue what the rules were, we just kind of made them up as we went along. My niece won, I think. It was kind of hard to tell when you didn't really have any rules who the winner was. Now Jesus, in our gospel lesson, we read that Jesus said to his disciples, "You have heard it said to those of ancient times." It was another way of saying it was told to people long ago. You have heard it said to those of ancient times, you shall not murder. That was part of the Ten Commandments, the basic rules that God gave to his people, the Israelites, through the prophet Moses. Jesus addressed his disciples regarding murder and judgment with these words, but I say to you, and with these words, the rules changed. Murder no longer meant just killing someone. It included being angry with another person, insulting them, and calling them a fool. Reconciliation comes before bringing your sacrifice, Jesus said, and resolving differences before being called in front of the judge might keep you out of prison. Otherwise, there is no mercy, and the entire debt or punishment must be paid. You have heard it said again, Jesus points out one of the basic commandments, you shall not commit adultery. Be faithful to your spouse. This is the sixth commandment. The rule is about to change, however. It is no longer just a matter of infidelity. But I say to you, Jesus uses those words again, that everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery in his heart. Jesus told the disciples to get rid of whatever causes them to sin. It is better to break free of whatever is causing you to sin than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. It was also said, Jesus continues the previous theme of adultery by including divorce. But I say to you, it is more than a mere certificate. In some instances, divorce results in adultery. Another rule has been changed. The second commandment says, you shall not use the name of the Lord your God in vain. The eighth commandment says you should not bear false witness against your neighbor. Jesus said, again, you have heard it said to those of ancient times, you shall not swear falsely, but carry out the vows you have made to the Lord. Now, making vows or oaths to the Lord is a tradition that went way back to the earliest parts of Genesis. Genesis 14:22, but Abraham said to the king of Sodom, with raised hand I have sworn an oath to the Lord. There's well over 100 references of that kind of oath in Scripture. Jesus says the magic words, the words that transform ancient teachings, the words that change the rules for them. But I say to you, Jesus said, don't swear an oath at all, not by earth or by heaven. Just say yes and no, and it will keep you out of trouble. See, Jesus is a game changer. He takes the familiar and practical rules that we've heard, and he expands them. And it was more than Jesus just speaking these words. Jesus lived these new rules. He called ordinary people to be his disciples, a tax collector, fishermen, and others, instead of recruiting rich executives. He encouraged people to love their enemies and to not judge others. Jesus changed the rules when he reached out and he touched an unclean leper to heal him, because touching this unclean leper made Jesus unclean. Jesus healed the servant of a centurion, a Roman military officer, at a time when the Jews were oppressed subjects of the Roman emperor. Jesus healed Israelites, and Jesus healed Gentiles. He healed blind, crippled, and deaf people. Jesus defied Sabbath rules by healing on the Sabbath, and he told stories. They were parables based on ordinary things and that ordinary people in Jesus' time would be familiar with, like planting seeds, and a wedding banquet, and a vineyard. Twice, Jesus fed thousands of people at one time, and they were all satisfied. And Jesus broke natural laws, too. Jesus calmed the storm, and Jesus walked on water. And Jesus loved children in a society where children did not have much value. Jesus' life and ministry changed the rules. Jesus said he didn't set out to abolish the law, but to fulfill it. Knowing that humans could never be free from sin, Jesus did what only the sinless Son of God could do. He took our sin, our failures, our inability to follow the rules, and restored the relationship between God and man that was torn apart by sin. It was the ultimate game changer, because we are unable to earn our way into heaven. Instead, salvation is a free gift from God. It is God's grace. And grace is God's undeserved love for us, proven to us when Jesus died on the cross and rose 3 days later. You probably know this is Super Bowl Sunday. I'm guessing you've heard that. In football world, this is the big game. Two teams will play each other in a game that is watched by millions of people. Both teams must follow the rules or be penalized for their actions. If the Super Bowl were to change the rules to protect the players from serious injury, this would ultimately be a good thing. However, the game would be confusing without a demonstration, or at least an explanation, to understand what these new rules are, how they apply, and why they are changed. There would be accusations of unfairness. The scripture gives us rules to follow. Do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not bear false witness, are some of them. Jesus changes these rules. He expands them to include anger, divorce, and sworn oaths. Jesus demonstrates for us how to live by these rules, to forgive one another, to reconcile differences, and to care for each other. These new rules do not change God's grace for us, but they help us understand how we are to live as people who have received God's grace. The writer of Psalm 119, and then this is in the celebrate insert, reminds us that there is joy in following the Lord and obeying his laws. Happy are they whose way is blameless, who follow the teaching of the Lord. Happy are they who observe your decrees and seek you with all their hearts, who never do any wrong, but always walk in your ways. You laid down your commandments that we should fully keep them. Oh, that my ways were made so direct that I might keep your statutes. Then I should not be put to shame when I regard all your commandments. I will thank you with a true heart when I have learned your righteous judgments. I will keep your statutes. Do not utterly forsake me. Amen. We continue our worship with hymn number 772. Please stand as you're able. We confess our faith together using the words of the Apostles' Creed. It's on page 6 of the bulletin. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Sweet prayers of intercession are found on the back of the Celebrate. Called together to follow Jesus, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Inspire your church that it may be a sign of life throughout the world. From the exploration of faith with children and new believers to missionaries and bishops, shape lives of faithfulness so that all find abundant life in your ways. Merciful God, nourish your creation. Accompany all who plant and water. Bless the work of farmers. Provide for subsistence farmers and those facing drought and climate change. Guide the work of agricultural scientists toward sustainable ways to feed the world. Merciful God, give growth where there seems to be no hope for life, in nations and regions where reconciliation seems impossible. Empower peacemakers with your spirit. Where death holds sway through violence, disease, and hunger, and also, Lord, through hurricanes and tornadoes and earthquakes, equip relief workers to bring hope. Merciful God, nurture all in need, especially we pray for Rod and Irvin and Everett and Adam and Jan and Riley and Perry and Joanne and Brett and Laverta and Gail and Josh and Michael. And we pray prayers of comfort for the family and friends of Dale Ahrens and for others who have recently lost loved ones. And we pray also for our homebound families and friends. Bring healing to all who experience trauma caused by systems of injustice and destructive relationships. Give courage to those struggling to repent and those seeking reconciliation. Sustain all who work for restoration. Merciful God, encourage this congregation. Call us to a common purpose and keep us from quarreling. Turn our hearts toward you and guide our leaders so that our choices may be life-giving for all. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Thanks be to you for the lives of all who have died in Christ. Teach us to follow them in your ways and gather us with them into the promise of eternal life with you. Merciful God, we bring to you our needs and hopes, O God, trusting your wisdom and power revealed in Christ crucified. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. And you may share Christ's peace with each other. We have the offering. Thank you. Pray the offering prayer together. It's on page 8. Liberating God, you break the bonds of injustice and let the oppressed go free. Receive these offerings in thanksgiving for all your works of merciful power and shape us as people of your justice and freedom. You we magnify and adore. Through Jesus our Savior. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The God who faithfully brings forth justice and breaks the oppressor's rod, bless, strengthen, and uphold you today and always. Amen. Our sending hymn is 818. Thank you. in peace. Follow the way of Jesus.